So carrying on from the last video where we was talking about a fault loop impedance and three lead low, two lead high and two lead low. We obviously seen a measurement of three lead low and two lead low. We couldn't do the two lead high, however, because we know now that that will actually cause an RCBO or an RCD to disconnect. So this video is following on from that. And basically we're going to now use the two lead high setting, okay, which I've got on my tester here. As you can see, it's set to the LPE and the impedance values on the tester, and it is set to two lead high. What we're gonna do now is we're actually gonna measure our external fault loop impedance, our ZE. Now, because there isn't an RCD down circuit, because this is effectively coming straight into the incomer, etc., it shouldn't cause an issue, and we should be able to get a reading. Okay, so I'm gonna connect onto my earthing conductor, which you notice I've actually disconnected. So the whole idea is, we actually want to make sure that the earthing conductor and the supply authority's means of earthing they've provided us is actually what is giving us our path to earth, okay? So if I would have left it connected, maybe there might have been a gas pipe, water pipe, etc. If that earthing conductor was broken, we actually left it connected into the MET in this skeleton board here, okay? Then we might actually get an acceptable reading. However, that could actually mean that effectively we're using our incoming services such as gas and water as our means of earthing, which would not be a good idea. Okay, so I've actually disconnected it. Notice that the whole board is turned off. Okay, now again, disconnected our earthing conductor. So this is our means of earthing into the installation. If I was to leave this live and then there was a problem, let's say of a metal faceplate, then that could cause issues and danger to the customer or people in the area, okay? So because I've disconnected the earthing conductor, I've obviously now turned the whole installation off, okay? So onto the earthing conductor, and then I'm just gonna come onto my incoming line. And that has given me a reading, again, as you can see, quite a lot quicker than when we did the three lead low, of 0.23 ohms, okay? Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna follow on why we're doing this test, and we're actually gonna perform our prospective fault current. So now we're moving on to our prospective fault current, okay? And as before, we can carry on from this when we're doing our external earth fault loop impedance. The only difference now is I've reconnected the earthing conductor into the MET in the board, and this is to make sure all parallel earth paths are in place, okay? So what I'm gonna do is, I've connected to the MET, and I'm just gonna go on the incoming line conductor, and it gives me the voltage. And then rather than looking at the impedance value now, we're actually focusing on the number above it, which has given me 799 amps. So that is actually my prospective earth fault current, okay? The test isn't quite finished there. We need to then do our prospective short circuit current, and whichever one is the highest will actually become our IPF or our prospective fault current as such. And then we can have a look at the braking capacity on the side of our overcurrent protective devices and make sure they are adequate for the installation. So now we've done our prospective earth fault current, we're going to move on to our prospective short circuit current as we spoke about. Now this is between line and neutral. So I've got the tester here set to line and neutral loop, and in the back all I've had to do is swap the test lead terminal from the protective earth to the neutral terminal. So all I'm going to do is probe onto the incoming neutral and incoming line terminals. It's going to give me the voltage on the two lead high, and then you can see the results. So we don't actually need to massively worry about this, okay? We just need to focus on the prospective short circuit current it's given us, which is 759 amps. So now we have to look at the two, okay? The prospective earth fault current and the prospective short circuit current. Whichever is the highest actually becomes our prospective fault current. Now we then need to check them on the side of our overcurrent protective devices. In this installation, the overcurrent protective devices are rated at 6,000 amps, okay, so they're acceptable. So the braking capacity must, on the side of the devices we have, must be higher than our prospective fault current, okay, which they are in this installation. As always, we hope this video has been some help.